morning. I love the enthusiasm when we have Kinder first and second in here. We got a great countdown this morning for the start of chapel. Today is Wednesday. It is April the 28th, and I have two helpers here this morning from Ms. DeGroat's class to help us out with the pledges. I have Silas and Evan here. If you would please stand and join us for the pledges today.
Attention, salute pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the Bible, God's holy word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will hide its words in my heart that I might not sin against God.
Attention, salute, pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Please remain standing for our time of praise and worship today.
Come all you see. Good morning, Bethesda. It's so good to be here this morning and to hear you worshiping the Lord. We've been talking about playing on God's team. And today we're going to be talking about how a ball player becomes part of a team. Now, if you are a really good baseball player and you want to play for a professional team, what do you have to do to play for that team? Does anybody know? Just yell it out. You have to try out, and then if they say, okay, you can be a part of our team, you have to do something else. What do you have to do? You have to sign up. You have to sign up. We have to when you're signing up for a team, that means you're signing a contract, and you're saying, I'm going to play for that team. Now, most of the professional baseball teams, people know all about them, so they know kind of what they're getting into when they sign up for them. But let me introduce you to a couple of teams. We have the Woebegone Wipeouts, and we have the Lancaster Lionhearts. Now, the Woebegone Wipeouts are located in Florida near the beach. This is their training camp. They're right there on the beach. They have different activities that they get to do, like swimming with dolphins. They have a great training facility and a really beautiful park where they get to play. The Lancaster Lionhearts are located in West Texas, where the land is flat. There's not a lot to do. They also have a nice training facility and a nice baseball field that they can play on. How many people in here, looking at the outside, think that this team, the Woebegone Wipeouts, would be the better team to play for? Okay. How many people think the Lionhearts would be the better team to play for? All right. Let's look at one more thing before we decide who we're going to sign up for. Let's look at their stats. The stats are the statistics. The Woebegone Wipeouts have never won a game. Their record is 0-253. They have the world record for the number of errors in one game, and the pitcher has walked every single batter for the past 10 seasons. The Lionhearts have never lost a game. They are the world champions. Their pitcher holds the record for the number of strikeouts. Every team member is a Hall of Famer. Every team member gets to go to the Baseball Hall of Fame. Now, how many people want to play for the Wipeouts? How many people want to play for the Lionhearts? Yeah, now that we look at their statistics, the things about them, we see which would really be the better team to play for, right? The Wipeouts kind of looked good on the surface, but they're the losers. The Lionhearts didn't look quite as good on the surface, but look, they're the winners. If we sign a lifetime contract with a team before knowing these kinds of things about them, it could be a bad thing for you. You would never get noticed. You'd always be known as a loser if you signed up for that team. You know, Satan is that way. He tries to make it look like signing up for his team would be really great. You'll have lots of fun. Life will be wonderful. Look at how many wonderful things you can have if you play on my team. Jesus doesn't promise us that everything will be wonderful. But we know that in the end, Jesus' team is going to win the game, right? Jesus is going to defeat Satan. So we know that if we're on Jesus' team, we're going to be on the winning team. It might not look as fun and as exciting and all of that kind of thing, but we know who's going to be the winner. And would you rather be on the winning team or the losing team? Yeah, we want to be on the winning team. So before you sign up for a team, it's good to ask questions about that team. Now today we're going to learn about a follower of Jesus who had a lot of questions and went to get them answered. He wasn't one of the 12 apostles that we've been talking about, but he was still a follower of Jesus and someone who wanted to be on Jesus' team. That man's name was Nicodemus. Nicodemus went to Jesus one night. He came at night, maybe because he didn't want anybody else to see him come. He was a teacher, a leader of the Israelites. And maybe he was just so excited about talking to Jesus he couldn't wait till the next morning, but probably he didn't want other leaders to see him talking to Jesus. And he had a lot of questions. He had been watching Jesus perform miracles, and he really wanted to know more about Jesus. He went to Jesus and he said, "Your miracles show us that you are sent from God. No one can do what you do unless God is with him." So Nicodemus recognized that Jesus had come from God, and that he had to have the power of God to do the things that he did. Jesus answered Nicodemus, "Unless you are born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus didn't understand Jesus' answer. How can I become a baby and be born again? How can an adult be a baby again? Jesus wasn't talking about Nicodemus coming a physical baby again. He was talking about his spiritual life. Jesus said, "Unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." Jesus meant that each of us is born as a baby with a sinful nature. Sin, remember, is anything we do that is against God, that keeps us from pleasing God. The Bible tells us that all of us have sinned and come short of the glory of God. God says we must be punished, and the punishment is being separated from God forever. To be born again means that our spirit is born into the kingdom of God. Jesus was talking about the spirit of Nicodemus, not his physical body. He said that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. We can't see the Holy Spirit, but he makes us a new person when we ask Jesus into our hearts. We become part of God's family, and we start playing on God's team. Nicodemus still didn't quite understand everything that Jesus was saying. So Jesus was surprised. He said, "Nicodemus, you're a teacher of Israel, and you don't understand these things?" Jesus told Nicodemus that what he spoke was the truth, that no one seemed to believe in him. Jesus told Nicodemus he knew this was the truth because he had come from heaven and was a witness. Jesus reminded Nicodemus about the Israelites in the wilderness. He reminded them about how the Israelites had to look at that snake on the pole and they would live. Those of you who have learned about Moses know what I'm talking about. But God also instructed Moses that they just needed to look and they would live. Jesus explained to Nicodemus that this one verse that we sang about and we all know, this is a verse that Jesus said to Nicodemus, "For God so loved the world," say it with me, "that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have." John 3:16. Jesus had never sinned. He didn't deserve to take the punishment that we should have received for our sin. But he came and he died on the cross and was resurrected so that we could live with God forever. The Bible tells us later that Nicodemus accepted Jesus' teaching, and Jesus gave him eternal life. He was born again. After Jesus died, Nicodemus took spices and helped prepare Jesus' body to be buried. He finally understood what Jesus was saying. Jesus also came for each one of us who wants to be born again. He took our punishment that we deserve for our sin. You know, I heard a story one time about a little boy that lived in a small village somewhere in Germany. And this little boy, his family was very, very poor. And when he would go to school, it was a long time ago, and they were in those schools that all the grades were in one room. And he would come to school, and he would have like maybe a piece of bread in his lunch. And these other people would have lots of lunch. And there was one big boy in there who always had a really big lunch. And one day this boy came to school and he didn't even have a piece of bread. They didn't have any bread in their house. He was hungry. But he was kind of ashamed of not having the food. He didn't want all the people to know how poor he was. So when they were out at recess, he snuck in and he stole that big boy's lunch. And the teacher saw him. So when they all came back in from recess, this teacher called that little boy up and yelled at him in front of everybody for stealing that lunch. You're a thief. You're not supposed to be stealing that lunch. You deserve to be punished. And he said he was going to whip him in front of the rest of the class. This was back when they could do that. And just as the teacher got out that whip, the big boy in the back stood up and came to the front of the room, and he said, I'll take his punishment for him. And so he took the whipping that the little boy deserved for him. Did the big boy steal the lunch? No. But he took the punishment because he felt sorry for the little boy. Kind of the same way, even more so, Jesus took the punishment we deserve for our sin so that we could have eternal life. I hope that each one of you have made a decision to play on God's team, to ask Jesus to be your Savior, and thanked him for taking the punishment that you deserve so that you can have eternal life. If you have not asked Jesus to be your Savior, why not? Why not do that today? You can go to your teachers, you can go to anybody here at the school, and you can ask them, help me to learn to pray, to ask Jesus to be your Savior. If you want Jesus to be your Savior, you can even pray right now. I want you to bow your heads, close your eyes. If you want Jesus to be your Savior, you could pray a prayer like this. Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I know that I have committed sins against you, but I believe that you took the punishment for my sin. And I pray that you will come into my heart and forgive me of my sins. I believe that you live in heaven and are preparing a place for me someday. And I thank you that you've promised that if we believe in you and ask, we will receive eternal life. Now, if you prayed a prayer like that, go to your teacher today and tell them. Ask them to pray with you also. And tell other people that you have Jesus in your heart now. Make that announcement to everybody. Because if you signed up for the winning team, you'd want everybody to know, right? Well, if you've asked Jesus into your heart, you've signed up for the winning team. Tell everybody. Let everybody know. Because one day, Jesus is going to come back, and the game's going to be over. And we'll be on the winning team. Thank you for your attention today.
Thank you, Ms. Patton. I love the story of Nicodemus, and I love how Jesus was so patient to sit and listen and answer each one of his questions. We are blessed to have wonderful teachers here at Bethesda who will do the same with you. So if you do have questions or you want to know more about God's plan for your life and how to be a part of his team, please do. Use Nicodemus as your example. Sit and ask questions. Get those answers so that you can know more about the Lord's plan for your life. We are celebrating today several ladies who have been such a big part of our chapel this year. This is the last time that Ms. Patton's going to be teaching chapel this year, so I just want to say a special thank you to Ms. Patton, also to Pastor Brenda and Ms. Kimber, who have been a big part of our lessons this year. Would you help me give them a round of applause? These ladies have worked faithfully week after week to prepare praise and worship songs, helping to select those, helping out to prepare lessons, and helping to be ready every week for us to be a part of God's word and to be able to jump in and learn more about the plans that he has for our lives. Also today, we are celebrating three new pieces of artwork that have been added to my office for the month of May. I love having your work on display and being able to share that with visitors and guests that I have come into my office. So three pieces of artwork this month are on display from some of our upper elementary kiddos. I have artwork from Jake Austin. Oh, this one is Braylee Morrow. Braylee made this in art class. It's a sketch, I think, made with colored pencils. I love how realistic Braylee's artwork looks. There's also a piece by Abram Alexander. He's added lots of fruit and citrus there. And the last one is a three-dimensional artwork by Jake Austin Hancock. So for each of you guys, I have a certificate that says that your artwork is on display in the principal's office for the month, and I will be by to hand those out and share those with you later today. I'd love to see that. Our fifth grade is leaving to go on a field trip later this morning. They are going to the city of Cleburne, and we are excited to wish them well on their field trip today, going to Mainstay Farm. We also have first grade going not too much longer until they have their field trip, and we have kindergarten going to the zoo later in May. So it's been an exciting month. So glad that second grade had a great trip to the botanical gardens yesterday. Remember the special events happening this week, like the book fair. If you haven't brought money yet, if you would like to, you can do that this week and purchase items from our book fair. Mrs. Cannon's done a wonderful job with all of her volunteers setting that up for you to be able to get some great books to enjoy now or maybe even to read over the summer. Next week, we have a very special chapel that is happening. Our big kid band, they call it the Symphonic Band. Our middle school and high school students that play in the band will be giving us a concert. So next week, for the very first time, the entire elementary school is going to be in one room at the same time. We are going to be in the sanctuary next week, and there's lots of space for us to spread out. Everybody will have a seat. But when we go in, you will see the big kids and their instruments, and they are going to be putting on a concert for us. So I will see each of you this time next week in the sanctuary, and we will have a chapel concert. So I look forward to seeing you then. Have a wonderful week, and thanks for joining us today. Bye-bye.
Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen? Didn't know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through.
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made new?
We do.
Is all creation groaning?
Is
anyone worthy?
God to reign with the sun. Is it worth?